Maybe some of you have already given, but if not, the envelopes are available in the lobby, and or you can write on the memo line of your check that it's for the Christmas offering. Then we're going to have a baby dedication time. And so we have a group over here, and they're anxious to get started. So we put them at the very first of the service. So we're going to begin with a word of prayer and then share the video and go right into our time of worship together. Would you join me as we pray? Our Father, we rejoice for the opportunity to gather in this place today in the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Father, there's been a lot going on in the midst of our church family this week. You have called some very precious brothers and sisters home to be with you. We've been sharing in that experience, Father, and praying for those families and looking for ways to minister. But we thank you, Father, that while there is distance between some of us, there is no distance between them and you. And we ask you, Father, to minister and meet needs as you know them to be, even as we worship together this morning. We put this service into your hands, Father, and pray that it would be pleasing to you, and that you would tune our hearts to sing your praises, that you would have us open and receptive to your word this morning, and that we would both be blessed and be a blessing to those that are in this place as we gather here today. Thank you for Christmas and all that it means and all that it brings to us as your children. Now take charge of this service, Father. May it bring glory and honor to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Said, no, I need this Jesus. in Tanzania, bursting through the darkness like we've never seen before.
Right, let me invite all the parents and babies, godparents, y'all come on out. Except for the fellow on the far end, it's a pretty good-looking group. I'm going to stay right over here. Antioch Baptist Church, this is the future of the church. And these are families that are a part of the foundation and work of this ministry and of God's building in this community and in this church family. And we're glad for the opportunity this morning to celebrate with them as they present their babies and themselves to the Lord in an act of dedication. Mr. Curtius, are you here? All right. HD, you're going to have to make room on this. I've got Kasiah back there. And Marie, you come on up. Now, we are following a biblical mandate here because the scripture says that Hannah brought Samuel to the temple to present him to the Lord and to commit him to the Lord's purposes. And then Mary and Joseph brought Jesus to the temple for dedication. And so these parents bring their children this morning for dedication to the Lord. And as I said, this is as much a dedication of the parents as it is of the children. And just a wonderful looking group. So I'm going to let them take the microphone and pass it down. We have some that don't want to talk and some who can't talk this morning. But if you can get out your name and the name of your baby and just pass the mic down to the next person, that's what we'll do.
Adam and Alex Walters. This is Monroe Island.
I'm standing in for Anthony. This is Gavin Ash Pittman, and his parents are Kelsey and Anthony Pittman.
We are Corey and Caitlin Walters, and this is Jennifer James.
I'm Lexi, and this is Linda Pittman.
I'm Trey, and this is Christy Britt. This is Donna Ray Britt the fourth, and he's going to go by the room.
We are Joseph and Stephanie Skipper, and this is Brody Andrew Skipper.
This is my daughter, Kristen. Grandbaby, Jameson, David, and Rick, and you'll be here all in January.
Good morning, Intact. My name is Molly, and I got Kazea for you.
Thing on the earth. The second thing we acknowledge is that just like mom and dad, these children have need of a Savior. They're born in innocence, but the Bible says we're all born in sin. And so we have to teach our children how to tell the truth, how to share, how to be good friends with others, not to take things that don't belong. I didn't have to teach my kids how to do those things. I had to teach them how not to, because they're born with that proclivity to do what they shouldn't. We also acknowledge that for these children, Jesus is the only Savior. And parents, you're making a commitment this morning to dedicate these children and yourself to the Lord and to do exactly what the Word of God encourages us to do. And so I'm going to ask you to answer, we do or I do, as I read these charges to you as parents. The first one is this. Do you here this day recognize your child as the gift of God and give heartfelt thanks to God for that blessing? Do you here this day dedicate your child to the Lord who gave them to you? Do you here in this day pledge as parents that you will bring up your child in the discipline and instruction of the Lord? Do you here this day promise to give your child every possible benefit of home, education, and the church? Do you here this day ask God's blessings upon your child's life to guide, guard, and direct your child through all his or her years? Church, there is a responsibility for all of us as a body of believers. And so I ask you this morning, will you as members of this congregation be faithful in your calling as members of the body of Christ and this local church specifically, to live a God-like and Christ-like example before these children, and at every opportunity do all you can to point them to Jesus Christ. Now, it's our opportunity and privilege every time we do a dedication of children to present several things to them. Moms and dads, today you will receive a certificate of dedication that you can keep to remember this day by. You will also receive a letter for each of your children, and it reads this way. On Sunday morning, December 16th, your parents presented themselves publicly before God and their church family to declare their promise to teach, train, and to guide your life according to God's word. They promised with the Lord's help to live a Christ-like example before you, and to always let you know God's love. God loves you and has a special personal plan for your life. As your parents made this special commitment, the people of Antioch Baptist Church committed themselves to pray for you and for you as parents, and to promise to help by teaching and living before you a godly example. Finally, your parents dedicated you to the Lord as we prayed together for your physical, emotional, and spiritual growth, as well as your well-being on your way through life. You're reading this letter now because your parents want you to know how your life journey began, because they are seeing in you now an interest and desire to know God in a more personal way. The Bible says that we have all sinned. Sin is anything that displeases God. When we repent of our sin and ask Jesus to forgive us, we believe on Jesus as our Savior, we are born again. That is, we are forgiven of our sin and adopted into the family of God. If this is what you're thinking about now, read the following questions and answers with your parents and talk about them. You are about to make the most important decision of your whole life. May God bless you as you think about how much you're loved by your parents, your church, and especially Jesus. These letters are given to each parent so that when their child comes to the age where they begin to ask questions concerning salvation, mom and dad can take this letter out and they can have the greatest blessing a parent can ever have, and that's to lead your child to saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. One of the wonderful things about being pastor for a long period of time is we've given these letters out since the first year I was here. And I've had the joy, and we as a church family have had the joy of seeing moms and dads bring their children forward as they profess Jesus Christ as their Savior, and even to watch dads get to baptize their children in obedience to our Lord's command. So, parents, godparents, if you would take your child and just kind of hold that baby out for just a moment in this direction, if they'll let you do that. For some reason, Jameson wants Papa. Yeah, smile at us out here. There you are. And we want to pray together, okay? My brother, let's pray. Father God, we acknowledge right now that you are the giver of life. And these parents hold in their arms the most precious gift you could give apart from salvation. And that is the life that you've entrusted to them to nurture and to instruct and to help to grow till they come to an understanding of Jesus Christ. We thank you for moms and dads, godparents, grandparents who love Jesus and are committed to helping their child or their grandchild to grow into his likeness. We pray for these children this morning, Father, thanking you that you've entrusted them to such good parents and asking, Lord, that you would bless them in physical growth, in emotional growth, and especially in their spiritual growth. We pray, Father, that they would develop just according to your plan and purpose. And we thank you for the potential that is before us this morning. We don't know what your plans are for these children, but your word declares they are plans for good. So we are seeing moms and dads hold such great possibility in their hands this morning. May they never forget that. And may we as a church family realize that also today. We ask your blessings of protection, stability, provision for each of these families this morning as they stand before us. And again, Father, we give you our thanks for these gifts. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, I'm going to do this the best I can without Pastor Keith's help. And so when I call your name, I'll ask you to come down and get your certificate and your letter, and we have a gift for you. And we're going to start with Brody Andrew Skipper. Every day, so we kind of already have a relationship going on there. Is there one left? Stony Ray Britt the Fourth, who is Drew. Now, this is his first service at Antioch, so what a wonderful way to start. I saw him sitting on Santa's lap He didn't look too happy. Santa didn't look too happy. But I kind of saved them for last for a reason. Because they cost me my secretary. He said that she would work until, and we were praying for a long time that that until would hurry up to this year. So we thank you. God bless you. Do you want to make a presentation? Okay. Let me get the microphone. You pass the baby over. I enjoy going to see all the newborns. I'm always jealous that most of them always have more hair than me right at the beginning, which isn't hard to do, but Isaiah really had a lot of hair. Okay? I'm going to give you the microphone and I'll hold you. Oh, that was I don't know. We'll leave that one right here. We'll go to the next one.
Good morning, Inche.
Already, I say I love you. This is an opportunity to thank Pastor Mark for all he has done for us. We're going to offer this. It's a little thing, but we love you so much. Don't be jealous.
I'll share it.
It's a Shalom Universal Baptist Church honor with Pastor Mark, you know. Sense appreciation for, we sense appreciation for your dedication and loyalty we have contributed to the success of our church. And we give you a voice you can lead. Thank you.
Moving over to North Lumberton Baptist Church, where they will be closer to the community of believers that are part of their church family. But I would encourage you, if you've never had a chance to sit in on a service, even if you can't understand half of the language they're speaking, the Holy Spirit will still bless you, talk some. So we appreciate that very much, and our prayers go with you as you make that transition. All right, I think we're ready to continue with worship. Pre-K choir.
She is
like to ask that if you are a family member of one of those that was dedicated this morning before the Lord, would you stand back to your feet for a moment so the church family can acknowledge you? And we'd like to express our appreciation to you for being a part of this time of worship this morning. As you're seated, I'm going to ask Tony Britt, which number are you, 3? Work a little harder, you might make it up to number 10. I'm going to ask Tony if you would to ask God to bless the gifts this morning as we worship.
Thank you.
comes to minister in song. A couple of things I'd like to mention to our church family. I know most of you are aware of the fact that Bobby Williams passed away this last week. Keith and Sandy are with the family in Lakeland, Florida. The visitation for the family is tonight, and the funeral services are tomorrow. And tonight we will have a special time of prayer for that family, also for some of the families in our own church body, including Mrs. Virginia Phillips, who will be going for some testing tomorrow concerning a diagnosis that she has received. We also want to be praying for Billy Allen, who's here with us this morning after the process of recovery. Though we were not able a moment ago to recognize one person who needed to stand for the baby dedication, and she's not able to right now, but this is Helen Skipper's first Sunday back to the church family since she fell and fractured her knee, and she is healing well, and we're glad she can be with us today, and I want to take time to Well, this is also Cindy Wilcox's first opportunity to be back with her church family since her dad's homegoing, and so we're glad that she's able to be with us today for this special time with Monroe. She's already spoiled Maverick, so now I know you're working hard on the second one. And Miss Doris Sellers went home to be with the Lord this past week, and yesterday we learned that our church custodian that works for our school also, Miss Robin, her dad passed away yesterday. So there's been a lot going on in our church body in these last several days, and I'm grateful for you as prayer warriors. And so now I'm going to become a minister.
Thank you.
copy of God's Word this morning, turn with me to Luke's Gospel, chapter 2. We'll begin reading in a moment, verse 25. And if you're noticing, things look a little bit different this morning. They spent this last week installing the new projection system. And it's a whole lot more than just the projectors that you see. And we have some special supervision in the sound booth this morning that's trying to help us make sure everything goes as it should. But Pastor Kevin says, understand there's going to be a learning curve. So we'll tweak it a little bit, but I hope you can see a difference already. And what difference I see is this. All the children left right after they performed this morning because they're having breakfast in Bethlehem right next door in the chapel this morning for all the children. You're waiting to have breakfast at Lumberton. And I'm looking at the back screen, and unlike the one in the front, there's a clock on the back one that tells me exactly what time it is. 11:08. Which means absolutely nothing to the preacher. But if you begin to wonder what's going on, turn your head and look at the back screen. Here we are in Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, beginning in verse 25. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death until he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child, Jesus, to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took Jesus up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for the glory to your people Israel. And God bless his word this morning as it goes out. Just a brief time of sharing this morning in light of all the things that we've done. But I'm thinking about Christmas, and y'all know this is my favorite time of year. If it's your favorite time of year, just slip your hand up right now and say, we love Christmas. Yeah. The rest of you get saved and you'll be right, okay? Love Christmas. Now here's what I remember about Christmas as a child. We would make our list and we would tell Mom and Dad, now this is what we want for Christmas. And we put the most important thing at the very top of the list. Y'all do that? And I can remember on a Christmas morning rushing into the living room to look under the Christmas tree for that number one, top of the list gift that I've been waiting for it seemed like 10 years, but it was only 2 weeks. And I remember this particular Christmas when we all went into the living room and I started looking through everything. And George, I looked through all of it and my number one top of the list gift wasn't there. Now I had lots of other stuff, but the thing I wanted most didn't show up. And so being the nice young little boy that I was, I copped an attitude and pouted and acted disappointed. You know, I made Mom and Dad feel real good. Because even though I had all this other stuff, I didn't get the one thing I wanted that I waited for. And so I had to let them know how displeased Eric I was. Now, I know none of y'all have ever been guilty of that, right? Because you always get exactly what you want. Now, another Christmas, I remember we were in Sanford. And Brandon was of the age now that Christmas, you know, when they're little like these this morning, you can give them the box that the gift comes in, they're happy. Give them a bow on the package, they're happy. But when they get to that age where they know, you know. And at that particular time, the thing on the top of his list was He-Man. Y'all are old enough to remember He-Man. We went all over Lumberton, all over Sanford, all over Lee County, Robinson County, Scotland County, any county. We went all over the place, Diane, looking for He-Man. And he was not to be found. Now, I read stories about fistfights in department stores because parents found the last one of something and had to fight over it. But you see, as a parent, knowing what your child wants more than anything for Christmas, it's your priority and utmost desire to get them what they want, isn't it? I mean, that's the most, we don't want our child to be disappointed at what they're expecting to get for Christmas. So Christmas sometimes brings disappointment when we don't get what we wanted most of all, especially when we've waited. Well, now enters Simeon. Simeon has been waiting. He's been waiting for that which he wants more than anything in the world. He wants to see the Savior. He wants to see that gift that God had promised 4,000 years earlier. You talk about waiting. The people of God have been waiting since Genesis chapter 3. They've been waiting for 4,000 years for this promised one whom God said, I will send into the world, not just to take care of the effect of sin, but I'm going to send one into the world that will take care of the cause of sin. And they've been waiting. And Simeon had been watching. And he enters the pages of God's Word in Luke chapter 2. We don't know a lot about him. We don't know where he's from. We don't know how old he is. We don't know his educational background. We don't know his family background. We don't know hardly anything about him. Last time I looked at my nativity scene, Greg, I don't find Simeon among the shepherds and the wise men and all the pieces we put out. But he's one of the most important figures of Christmas. Here he is, the scripture says, with one focus in his life. He's looking for the promised one, for the fulfillment of God's word in his lifetime. The one who would come and turn a world that was upside down, right side up again. And the Bible says he'd been looking and waiting for this moment of revelation. And can you imagine getting up every day and going out into the city, maybe going to the temple as he was that day? And every time someone walked by with a child, he says to the Holy Spirit, is that the one? Is that the one? We had eight of them up here a while ago. Is that the one? Is that the one? And every time he asked the question, the Holy Spirit said, no, not yet. No, not yet. No, not yet. Do you know the agony of waiting? Some of those mamas left with their kids, but I can tell you when you were around them in the eighth month, you came to understand the agony of waiting. This baby ain't never going to get here. Let's ride down the bumpy road. Let's take some castor oil. Let's do all these natural things people say that'll speed it up because we're tired of waiting. And the world has conditioned us to not do well with waiting. Right? None of us like to. I don't like to wait in line. You've ruined me. As pastor of Antioch Baptist Church, anytime we have something going on over there, you know what? Here, pastor, you and Karen go first. I try that at the food line. It don't work. I tell them who I am and where I'm from. They say, get in line with the rest of them. We don't want to wait. So when we go to Disney World, we get special passes and go put us in ahead of the crowd because we don't like to wait. I'm in the grocery store the other day and I got my wallet out and I'm thinking, Lord, if I could get one thing this Christmas, I'd like to get the guy. I'd like to get my hands around the throat of the guy who decided that swiping was not good enough. They had to put a chip in my car. So now I have to stick the chip in the thing and stand there and wait. Used to I just pop, pop, pop. Now I got to put the chip in and wait. And that's supposed to be better. Donna, it didn't say better. We're conditioned not to wait. Here is Simeon who's been waiting and waiting and waiting for the one thing that possessed his life. He wanted to see Jesus. Would to God that this Christmas you and I would be so enthralled by the promise of the Savior that the passion of our life, the focus of our life, the desire above everything else this Christmas is that we would see Jesus for who he really is. That we would long for that and wait for that until it was fulfilled. That's Simeon. He's watching. He's waiting. 40 days have passed since Jesus is born. And into the temple come Mary and Joseph and this baby. Now we don't know that Simeon was looking for a baby. He might have been looking for babies. He might have been looking for teenagers. He might have been looking for young men. The Holy Spirit didn't tell him anything specific, but the scripture did say a child would be born. Whatever he's thinking, whoever he's looking for, whatever age he's looking for, he's looking. And he's waiting, and he's watching. And here come Mary and Joseph. And maybe he's asking for the 10,000th time, is this the one? Is this the one? And Kevin, on this particular day, he says, is this the one? And the Holy Spirit says, yes, that's him. Can you imagine what that felt like? Can you imagine what went on in Simeon's heart at the moment that the Holy Spirit said, there's the one you've been waiting for. That's him. And Simeon says, wow, it's been worth the wait. And he takes the promise and cradles him in his arms and looks into the face of God incarnate, God in the flesh, we just sang about it. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. Hail, incarnate deity, pleased as man with men to dwell. And Simeon's holding God in his arms. And what he's waited for has come to pass. Waiting, why? Because he believed God for what God said. That's a simple statement this Christmas. But I have to be reminded sometimes that I can take God at his word and believe it. Because sometimes I forget that. Sometimes I forget what God has promised. He's waiting because he believes God is going to do what God said he's going to do. Do y'all believe that this morning? You believe God's going to do what he says?
Amen.
There has been given to us, the scripture says, exceeding great and precious promises. And the Bible says all the promises of God are yea and amen in Jesus Christ. And I want to remind us this morning that we have a God that we can trust because he does what he says he will do. And we can believe it. He's waiting. Waiting is an expression of our faith. When God wants to grow our faith and stretch our faith, you know what he often does? He puts us in the waiting room. And we learn by waiting what it means to trust and take God at his word. I admire Simeon. Joseph and Mary and the shepherds had angels that showed up and told them what was going on. Mary went to Elizabeth's house and John the Baptist did a little dance in Elizabeth's belly to let her know Jesus had just come into the room. The wise man had a star to follow. You know what it says about Simeon? He was filled with the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit rested upon him. The Bible says he was a devout man. That means he was a praying man. It says that he did according to the word of God. That means he knew the word. Now, we don't know anything much about Simeon, as I said, but here's what we do know. He was a devout and righteous man who was trusting in and believing the word of God. If that's all they can say about you this morning, that's pretty good. That's Simeon. He didn't have the angel's declaration. He didn't have all this external stuff going on. You know what he had? He had the internal word and voice God, the Holy Spirit. It said the Spirit revealed to him he wouldn't die until he saw the promise. Now I'm going to tell you, as the time ticks away, if God said you can live until you see the promise, I'm going to say, wonderful, Lord, put the promise way down here as far as you can. Because I'm not in a hurry to leave. But the Holy Spirit said, he revealed to Simeon, God is going to allow your life here to continue until you see what you've been longing to see, what you've been waiting to see, what you've been watching to see, what you've been expecting to see because you've trusted God's word. What a magnificent promise. He believed because God had sent it. Now, the other week, there were predictions of snow. And some of y'all were even crazy enough to say you hoped it was coming here. So we're watching the news. And the weatherman says, well, we're right on the line. And so we're going to get snow this side of 95, but we're going to get rain this side of 95. And the kids are watching the weatherman. And the kids all say, no school tomorrow, Tom. Because the weatherman says it's going to snow. And I said, well, it ain't snowing yet. And the weatherman says it's probably not coming our way. And even if he says it's coming our way, he's wrong more times than he's right. But you know what? Because those kids were expecting with anticipation for school to be out, they believed what the weatherman said. Even though he's wrong half the time. I have somebody a whole lot more reliable than the weatherman, and the forecast he makes for my life and for your life says God keeps his promises. He sent a Savior into the world, and whoever believes upon him shall have eternal life, shall never perish, shall be set free from the slavery of sin, will be set free from the fear of death, will overcome hell itself because God keeps his promise. Simeon's waiting because he believes God keeps his word. Well, that's why he's waiting. My next question would be, how long you been waiting? We don't know how old he is. Most Bible scholars, most pictures I've seen of Simeon, he's an old man, looks like me with a longer beard. He's old. But we don't know that. We're assuming that. We don't know how long he's been waiting. But when I read that he's been waiting and looking and waiting and looking, Greg, the question that comes to my heart is, how long am I willing to wait on God before I quit? You ever put God on a stopwatch and say, you've got this much time, God, to do what you said you're going to do, and then I'm moving on? Oh, no, I would never do that. I'm more spiritual than that. But, Lord, I've been praying about this for 6 months, and you haven't done nothing yet. I've been praying about this, Lord, for a year. You haven't done nothing yet. Lord, I've been praying about this child. I've been praying about this job. I've been praying about this situation for 6 years, 7 years, 10 years. And I'm still praying and you ain't done nothing yet. God, time's up. You ever do that? You ever get impatient waiting on God to do what God says he's going to do? Well, I do sometimes. And here's what happens when God delays. Norman, the first thing that happens, I start to doubt. Well, maybe I didn't really understand what God said. Maybe I need to go to somebody that's got a better degree or knows more Hebrew or Greek than me, and maybe I've been misreading this, and I need somebody to tell me where I've been wrong. You ever get in a place where God causes you to doubt? Listen, it's 25 after. Y'all talk to me when you get out, you know? How many of you ever doubt sometimes when God's not moved as fast as you think he should? And there's some doubt. The devil loves that, doesn't he? Hey, Tuesday night, they're telling me Bobby Williams is doing great. The nurse is saying to Karen, it's been a tough 3 months, but in the morning the team's going to come and see you and you're going to get some great news. And honey, the worst is over and I'm going to come across and give you a hug. That was Tuesday night. And on Thursday night, Bobby's home with Jesus. And I got some doubts. Lord, we've been praying, we've been watching, we've been hoping, we've been believing you were going to heal. You know what God said? I did. I did. And he's got Christmas with me. And I'm saying, that's wonderful, Lord, but what about Karen, and what about the kids, and what about the family? And doubt. And here's what happens. Once doubt comes in, here's what happens next, buddy. When God doesn't do it fast enough, or my timetable, I think I need to help him out. And that, there's where you really mess up, when you think God needs you to help him. You don't believe that, ask Abraham and Sarah. Abraham, you're going to have a child, and through him, I'm going to bless the whole world. Well, God, you take it too long, me and Sarah are going to handle this ourselves. Saul gets to the temple. He's going to make an offering. He's waiting on Samuel. Samuel didn't get there in a timely manner. So Saul says, I can handle this myself. And he takes it up into his hands. And you know what it cost him. And I'm going to tell you, every time I think I've got to help God out and I try to take it up in my hands, Rhoda, I make such a mess of it. Make such a mess of it. Church, we're in a time of waiting as a congregation, aren't we? Family, aren't we? We've been waiting over a year for a music person. And we're looking for a pastor. And we're going to be looking for a children's minister. And we're looking for a secretary. And we're looking for so much. And we're waiting.
and I'm tired of waiting. I'm telling God he hasn't moved fast enough, he's not working fast enough, he's not doing fast enough. Here's what the danger is, that you get so tired of waiting, you say, God, you've had your time, I'm handling this baby now. And that's what happens. Simeon didn't do that. Simeon is believing God for what he has said, and he's waiting on God even though he doesn't know how long it's going to take. He is continuing to wait and to watch, Milton. 24 years as pastor, here's what I've seen with people. I've seen people who come in and say, boy, I need God to change my life around. And starting today, Pastor, we're making a commitment. We're going to attend church like we ought to. And we're going to give our tithe to the Lord like we ought to, like he says we should. We're going to pray like we ought to. We're going to read our Bible like we ought to. And 3 or 4 months go by and God hadn't answered their prayer, and all of a sudden you can't find them. Because they gave God a deadline, and when God didn't meet their deadline, they disappeared. They gave up on him. Then they're done. Simeon didn't do that. He continued waiting on God. Because here's what Simeon found out. I'm going to go quickly and close. Simeon found out that while we're waiting, God's working. And Urban, he's not only working on it, he's working on me. In the waiting, he's working on what I've been praying about. You've been praying for that wayward child? Listen, God's working. Don't stop. You've been praying for that job that you need. You've been praying for that financial breakthrough that you need. You've been praying for a healing. And you listen, God's working, even if you're not seeing it in a moment. Simeon knew that. He believed that because God made a promise. So while Simeon is waiting and watching, he knows God's working. And he's doing more work on you while you're waiting than he's doing on what he's working on to get your prayer answered. That'll keep you going. It's a tough time. Then Simeon. Well, what do you do while you're waiting? When I was starting out in ministry, and you went to the hospital because somebody in the church was having a baby, they never asked the pastor to go into the delivery room. They never said, hey, preacher, we have a suite. And she's in the bed and there's reclining chairs and you can go back there if the family don't care. You can go back there and sit right there with them. No, thank you. My wife did. I've been with a lot of y'all when you deliver. I've been where I'm supposed to be. I've been out in the waiting room doing what you're supposed to do while you're waiting. That's because you don't smoke. What did Simeon do while he was waiting? Well, the Bible says that when he saw the child, where was he? He's in the temple. That's not a coincidence. You know what he was doing while he was waiting? He was worshiping. You know what you ought to do while you're waiting for God to do what God says he's going to do? Worship. Worship. One of the hardest things, Sue, that I ever have to do while I'm waiting is keep worshiping. Because my flesh doesn't want to. And my pride doesn't. My pride wants to say, if you're going through a hard time, hide. And it's all about me anyway, so if I don't want somebody to ask me about it, and I don't want somebody to tell me they're praying about it, and I don't want to have to, I'll just hide. I'll just stay away from church. I'll stay away from God's people. I'll just go into hiding while I'm waiting. No, you keep worshiping. And you worship on Monday. And you worship on Tuesday. And you worship the rest of the days of the week. And when Sunday comes, you be the first one through the door saying, I'm here believing God keeps his word. And while I'm waiting, I believe he's working. And while he's working and I'm waiting, I've come to worship. Now, here's what he said. Lord, let your servant depart in peace, for my eyes have seen what I've been looking for. In a world today that is desperate for peace, but looking for it in all the wrong places, you can leave here this morning with the peace of God.
if you believe his word. Peace with God and the peace of God. Candy's going to come to the piano. We're singing for a hymn of invitation. All to Jesus I surrender. I've sung that a lot because I have to do it over and over and over. Because so many times I say, I surrender, and then I take it back. So maybe this morning you're here and you've never come to find peace with God. It's only found in Jesus. But if you'll trust him today, if you'll receive that gift that was given, you'll have that peace. Peace with God, and then the peace of God. And if you're struggling this Christmas, if you've been praying for something and waiting on something, and God just hasn't performed that yet, his delay is not his denial. He's working. You just surrender it to him. Give it to him and keep on worshiping. Keep on believing the word. And the Holy Spirit of God will give you what you have need of. We're going to stand and we're going to sing. There's a decision you need to make this morning. The altar is yours, and the Father invites you to his peace. Needs to do. Just slip your hand up right quick. All right, thank you. Put it back down.